This is a story about David and his addiction and how this had an effect on himself and his family. This is where I've done a lot of my using. Being bitten by fleas. Not getting a bath. This is where a lot of the pain that I felt happened. This was the beginning of the end, really. I definitely feel emotional being back here. It's like just walking around in the same place as I used, and it's just surreal. It's like, did I actually live here? Did I do this? I go in the kitchen where I injected. I've just been in my mum's bedroom where I injected, and you know, and I nearly burnt the place down. When the mattress caught on fire, I've just been in there looking now, and it's horrible. And I just feel like that wasn't me. Do you know what I mean? It just feels weird. 14 and 15, I was fucking taking acid and stuff. And like, looking back now, I'd use drugs because I wanted a way out. And I found it in drugs. Because I fucking hated reality. I used to wish fucking UFOs to come and take me away. I used to look at the stars and think, just fucking get me out of here, man. I didn't understand this world and I felt misunderstood. Do you know, when I've always felt fucking somewhat like that. I think a lot of my childhood was based on fear. Do you know what I mean? Because I never felt settled. Because I was always pulled here, there, and everywhere. Dad was always in prison. Mum was always in that psychiatric hospital. So, never felt not that it's their fault. Just never felt settled. Mainly, I think the good times I had it when I felt relatively alright and I wasn't rattling. That's the only fucking good times that I had, just to have a little bit of peace. But that was very rare, because half the time I spent running round rattling, trying to get money for fucking drugs.
He's all funny and drugged up and filthy. I need £42. Honest to God, I'm going. I've got the phones here and everything. Don't believe you. He's told me that many lies, I didn't believe him. So he went away and he come back again. He said, please, look at the phone, lend me the money. I'll give it you back. I'm going rehab. I've had enough of everything. I'm sick of the way I am and what's going on, and how I've robbed people and got money off you and never give it you back and upset granddad, and because I, you know, my husband, his granddad don't approve of drugs at all. He was going mad and he would sneak things through the window to you, didn't he? And if he didn't answer the door, he'd throw little bricks at the window, didn't you? He was desperate then, and he'd come defiant to the door, and granddad would say, can I say it? F off, we've had enough, go on. We'll mind if it was for food or something, just get going. And he wouldn't go, he'd defiant. So we got a bucket of water and threw it at you, didn't he?
That'd be around where I lost my leg, where I started to give up. So after that happened, I thought, well, fuck it. Do you know what I mean? That's happened, I might as well just carry on and kill myself. Because I think, well, this is destined to be like this, and this is just the way it is. It's weird, yeah, that's it.
Got into pot in 1969. Been into drugs ever since, one kind or another. Got into smack when I was 48. Not used smack for 4 years, except a little cock up now and again. I'm quite settled now, waiting for that phone call. Oh, it was terrible, wasn't it? Every day, every time the phone rang. You didn't instantly think, oh, you know, this is it. You think, could this be it? Especially when someone was out of control. You're just waiting for a phone call every day, you know, say, oh, sorry, your son's dead. Mm. That bit was horrible. Mm. But being on the drugs myself, that sort of cushioned it. You know how drugs cushion you, don't they? Mm. You know, you don't feel things like you should. Mm. And you did your leg in. I didn't know what to say. Didn't know what to say to you. What do you say to somebody who's had that after leg off? Mm. You know, you feel it, but somehow you can't express it. Mm. You know what I mean? You're devastated, your son's lost a bleeding leg. How's it going to go on now? How's it going to work proper?
You know, I've been an addict most of my life, Dave. Mm. And it's never really bothered me, active addiction. I believe that if people want to use drugs, that's their choice. But it was different with you. Mm. And that's the first time I ever realised what it was like for my dad. Mm. Because before then, it was the only person I'm hurting, if I'm hurting anyone, is me. Nobody else. But then you came along when I met your dad. And that was different. That was terror. Still upsets me now, Dave. Mm. The thought that how many times we thought the door, knock on the door. And you know, because I met you before I met your dad. Mm. And I talked to you straight away in the detox, because we actually met in the detox. Mm. And I always felt dead protective of you then, if you remember.
Mm. Before that, you did your leg, didn't you? Mm. And you had your toe off. I could cope with that. It was just your toe and nobody could see that. And I had your leg off, come to see you. And I looked down and now your leg was gone. I just want to be sick. And I looked at you and you went, Jane, it's fine, I can cope with it, I'm fine. I thought, well, you're fine, what I'm saying, it's killing me inside, and I had to pretend as though it was fine, and it wasn't. Mm. And I just loved you and kissed you, and did you need anything? And, well, I don't think you felt that at the time, because you was in your own little world, you just wanted whatever Bert had brought you, mm-hmm. to block all the pain out again. Mm-hmm.
After the drug-induced episode and on Diaconal, you know, I'm watching her and disabled the kettle. But I walked in here and put a kettle on like this, and I was that desperate to fucking get out of the way I was doing, and kind of pulling this over my hands, red hot, pulling it on my chest. You know, because I put chemicals inside me.
And when you've done that to your hand, your mother come here with that many lies. And said, Dave, is this? And Grandad said, no, F up. Don't believe a word you're telling us. And you went through all that yourself, getting ambulance or whatever. Mm. And it was pitiful, wasn't it? Mm. Just melted. Mm. Couldn't believe it.
And then when you did your hands in, oh, fucking hell. That was awful, going up there every... Mm. Up to Whiston and... Put your hands in your stomach, get it on... How's he going to wash, how's he going to wipe his ass?
There's nobody, none of us thought we'd see you like this, especially when you did your hands. I was convinced after you'd done your hands that was it, you were going to kill yourself.
You know, there's other stuff that I've done. You know, it's like I fucking tried to burn my chest off. Being in hospital, they had to put my hands inside my stomach. Do you know, that's the real me. That's the stuff that I hide from you. This is the real me. David, with his leg. That's the real me. No, this is all the real me. But I have this thing that... I've done this to myself, and I have this thing today that... gets to me at times, and I live with what I've done. You know, there's no way changing time or turning back the clock. You know, I guess everything happens for a reason.
You burnt yourself and Isaac Daly burnt his hands. And he said, how bad is it? Your granddad was alive then. And Granny said, you know, you're not going and leaving to Rich without you lying again for getting money. So, my dad and Sue to see you. You wrapped up like a mummy. And Sue's your face, really. And the smell wasn't nice. And I walked in, I could feel myself shaking. And we just got it together. And the nurse come in. Your hair was all long and greasy. And your face was all blown, all your eyes were sinking. And she said, well, it's time for his tea. So I said, let me feed you. And started laughing. He said, yeah, for one. And I bought some grapes. When I was feeding, I said, do you remember when I was little? I was like, I was feeling like a kid. I said, you look good, get me. Put it at the side of your face, mum. I got outside and I just started crying soon. I cried hard and shook. I felt like my head was going to fall off. And when I got home, I just couldn't stop crying all night. And I just started crying soon. I cried hard and shook. I felt like my head was going to fall off. And when I got home, I just couldn't stop crying all night. Today that you were here and you're doing what you're doing, because I dreamt that you were in a box and you were dead. You were covered up all in white. All you could see was your face.
You know, I'd like that sort of relationship with my mum, but that ain't gonna be, because she's ill. This lad knows that I'm never gonna have a relationship what I want from my mum. I don't excuse some bits of how I felt about shit that went down in the past. You know what I mean, about my mum not actually being there. And, you know, there's a lot of things that... There's a lot of issues there, man. Right now, right, all I can get out of it is that I just feel fucking hurt by some of the stuff that's gone in the past. I feel bitter about it. I kind of fucking do. I do hold some blame towards, because otherwise I'd be closer to her, and I'm not. And I felt responsible for her as a teenager, because she was lost. because sometimes so much worse things could be different, but you know. And that's where the fucking pain starts, because things aren't as they are, and you know, I'd love to tell my mum things, but she's too fragile, she couldn't handle it. You know, be honest, I'd just say to mum, all she ever wanted was a fucking cuddle and for you to tell me that you love me. And she just went courage.
So now she's a big girl. All alone
at the end of evening, when the bright lights have faded and gone, you can spend all your time making money. You can spend all your money making time. If it all fell to pieces tomorrow, would you still be mine? You know I've always been a dreamer, spent my life running round, and it's so hard to take, can't seem to settle down. But the dreams I've seen lately keep me running back and coming back for more. So put me on the highway, show me a sign, and take it to the limit one more time.
You know, thinking about being here right now, that wasn't David. That was a fucking lost, lonely little boy who didn't know who he was. He wanted to be everybody else but himself. And just wanted some love. He didn't understand, he couldn't accept, he couldn't let people in. He didn't know how to. He didn't even know what was wrong with him. He was just this messed up kid. He had all his aspirations of leaving school and doing really well, and ended up 15 years with a fucking heroin addict. Several years of them being on methadone. You know, society today, you've got a problem and they could give you a problem to take a problem away. How can you give somebody a drug for a drug problem? It's like giving somebody a fucking nettle sting because they've been stung by nettles. That don't work, you're just going to get more fucking rashes. And society says once an addict, always an addict, and that's the biggest load of bullshit I've ever fucking heard. You know, I even said in hospital that I probably could never play a guitar again, and I do today, and I'm not a fucking using addict today. I'm an addict who's in recovery. I fucking met Natalie, a girl of my dreams, with her 7 years, I had a baby daughter with her, and you know, I thought I'd get some normality in my life. Maybe that'll rub off on me. I've got a job. It never lasted, I always end up the same. In and out of detoxes, in and out of jails. But I always ended up fucking back where I thought I belonged. I was usually with other using addicts. But saying that, it's a double-edged sword, because it's like, without doing what I've done, maybe I won't be here now talking to you. Maybe I'd be where my mate is. Underneath a gravestone, rotted flesh and bones. Not with us, not in this world. So maybe by doing what I've done is why I'm here today. And my past has shaped my future, maybe. But also the past is so painful.
I came here to St Anne's-on-Sea 4.5 years ago, and two people, two angels from the CDT, brought me to Pierpoint House. The best move I'd ever made. I just want to say thank you, and that I'm grateful to the people who've helped me along the way. This is where my life began. A chance to build bridges between me and my family. A chance to start a new way of life. And I thank God for this second chance.
I'm not going to end up where my friend ended up, Neil John Evans. I just want to dedicate this short film to him. Died when he was 20. Just want to say, shine on your crazy diamond.
blinded by the truth in a world that I collide. Stars shine way above the clouds in a world that brings me down. Every day I wear my insides out, head up high, just wanna fly.